Hi. First of all, thanks to the organizer for giving us the opportunity to share a little bit of what we are doing with data at Cabify back to the community. So hopefully you can avoid some of our mistakes and take some of our learnings. The title of the talk is One Journey Wiser. This is simply because our approach to the way we do things in data team at Cabify is that every time we bring someone from A to B, we should learn something so that future riders and future drivers have a better experience. So that's like the motto of the team. About us, I mean, because we are in Madrid, when I do these presentations abroad, it's not so common, but because we are playing home, probably most of you know what Cabify is. We are a ride-hailing company. We are a unicorn. We operate in Spain and in Latin America. And I'm telling you a little bit about what probably you don't know. Probably you know Cabify, but if you see, I'm using this maxi mobility thing because at Cabify, we thought it might be boring to be just doing ride-hailing. And therefore, we started a couple of years ago expanding our efforts. And now we not only have classic black cars, but we also, a significant fraction of our volume is with taxis in Latin America. And this is the biggest, the most increasing vertical that we have with electric mopeds, scooters, and e-bikes with the Movo brand. And of course, because this was not enough, we also enter into the fintech space with Lana that is targeting the problems of our users, especially in Latin America. The data team, in principle, the strategy I'm presenting is the same for all verticals. But obviously, because it's the biggest portion of what we have done so far is ride-hailing, it will be ride-hailing focus. Probably what you don't know, and it probably help understand why we are doing all these things that we are doing, is because our vision is that within technology can have a transformational effect in cities. This is the corporate vision. And when we go to the mission, as you see there, it's clearly highlighted that data and technology has to be the ways so we get that improvement in the cities what we operate. So we have this at the very core of the entire Maxi organization. Another thing you probably don't know, or maybe you know but you haven't realized, is that despite being a unicorn, most of our competitors are 20 to 50 times bigger than us. So for us, standing in the shoulders of the giants, these things that you say about science, like we have to build on top of what other people did before, it's mandatory. It's like we cannot reinvent wheels. We cannot afford that. So the way we envision that we can provide a better experience to the people in our platform is that we think that automating decision makers are the way to go. Google is the company in the world that is probably the best in organizing information, not because they have the best librarian, because it's the algorithms within Google, those who have learned and keep improving on ways to organize and synthesize information. Right, so that's the kind of approach that we want to bring here. I want to be the best in transportation, not because I have the best transportation classic professional, but because my systems are learning on how to move people from A to B in a more effective way. This is when I joined the company in mid-2017, so a couple years ago. This was me, all lonely. And we have a couple of data engineers, and yes, because it's an operation-based business, we already have a comparatively large business intelligence team because you know we need to do operations. As of now, this is where we are. As you can see, the team has increased significantly, and this is where we plan to be in 1 year. And as you see, all these spaces are opportunities. And just an idea is that you take this page and bookmark it. And maybe once a month, you can check if there is something for you there. I'm waiting for the pictures in this one. Okay. I'm going to tell you about how we build smart decisions. And first, a huge disclaimer. First thing I'm going to tell is about how Narnia looks, how if everything would be wonderful, how things are. But then we know things are not wonderful, right? So I wanted to say this from the beginning. First thing we do is we dimension the problem or the opportunity that we are trying to tackle. We go from anecdotal evidence, you have this many drivers angry because this didn't work, to something that we can measure and see the evolution, see if it's getting worse, is getting better, what's the real impact of this in the business. And of course, we can consider this a problem or an opportunity. If you are an optimistic, you will see an opportunity. If you're a pessimistic, you will see a problem. And we need both of the profiles in the projects. We learn that. Then, if we see that the problem is worth, because as I said, we don't have as many resources as others we are competing with, we prototype a model that solves the problem or up to a point solves the problem. In this phase, we validate the prototype against either cold data or what we call in shadow, which is something kind of cool. It's like we listen to production, but we don't make decisions in the marketplace, but rather we write what we would have decided. The reason for that is because, by definition, I cannot affect any real user. I can take bigger risk, right? Then it comes the production ready. You know, I had this prototype. It was a poorly written script in Python, whatever, but with a super valuable insight. And I want to scale it so that I can serve all of my users in the platform. And here, for sure, real engineering is needed. Hopefully, this finishes. And then we go to the inference part. That is, basically, we need to establish a causal relationship between this thing we built and check if it fixes the problem it tried to fix or if it brings the value we expected in the prototype. Basically, this is by experimenting, treatment and control, A-B testing, and all of these things that you are probably familiar with. But this is basically how it should work. In order to ensure we do it right, this is a bit of what we do, and this is a bit of how we do, we are copy-pasting Airbnb, and I am saying this with pride, because there is a post I completely recommend, which is scaling knowledge at Airbnb. So we are doing the same thing at Cabify. It basically revolves around this open source tool, Knowledge Repo, that if you haven't tried, I highly recommend. That focuses on providing quality, reproducibility, consumability, and discoverability on the research that we do. How? Okay, how do you provide quality? Python notebooks. Love it. Amazing. Very good. I want to review. I hate them, right? Like, how do I provide feedback to a peer on top of an IPython notebook? We tried collaboratory. We tried many things. None of them we like at all. And then we found this thing, which is like, OK, get some tool that from a non-reviewable Python notebook creates a reviewable markdown. And then you can jump on top of all things, like GitHub, GitLab, or whatever the things software developers have been using for 15 years to give each other feedback. And having this idea of the pull requests or merge requests and stuff. Reproducibility. What we do with Knowledge Repo is like anything we publish in the repo has control version notebooks and frozen data. Frozen data because the cost of this is like 10 cents a month, 10 US dollar cents. So why wouldn't you freeze the data of this prototype that you did, right? We are living in the cloud age. Everything is so cheap. So let's make sure that the data scientist 1 year or the data engineer 1 year in the future can reproduce this thing that we did here. Consumability. We are already an organization with over 1,000 people. So communicating about the things we learn is far from trivial to all stakeholders. And our idea here is that all of our deliverables have a 100-word TLDR, a key figure, and then they have this structure of an executive summary that cannot have code. Then we have a scientific report that allows you to reproduce, and there you have the code. And then discoverability. We have now over 150 posts in the knowledge repo. So how does a person who works in rider growth get to the things they need? So what we are using is tags and subscription. And actually, this is a feature that we added into the Airbnb knowledge repo. Actually, the engineer that built it is seated over there. And basically allows that if you subscribe to the rider tag, from now on, everything published in the repo will get to you in your @cabify.com email, which is the tool that we also use for authentication. And again, this is Narnia. This is if everything could be wonderful. Now I'm going to get real. And I'm going to get real telling you a data story about a problem. Our problem slash project slash product is smart rider engagement. And start with the question that, okay, we are pretty sure we spend lots of money in retention efforts every year. You can probably ride hailing is the most subsidized history in the industry in the history of mankind, and I measure that in the terms of billions raised from venture capital. Guess where they end up, right? So we had this idea 2 years ago or 1.5 years ago that this is worth for real. Like, can we do better? And then we start problem dimensioning. And hypothetically, each of these squares is tens of thousands of dollars, right? And these are different kinds of retention efforts that we do. And this is from a market for a period of time. And then we repeat this for all the markets over same period of time. And we start getting some stories. And then among many other things, we find that we have a very fragmented ecosystem that we don't have a joint effort on how we are approaching retention and almost no intel in being generated. So remember the title of the talk is One Journey Wiser. We realized that by giving discounts to people, we were just getting poorer because we were not learning. There were like very little insights after millions in investment of like what's the most effective way to retain a user in a ride-hailing platform. We were not generating that knowledge, and we thought we could do something about it. So, because the opportunity, I think you will agree with me, that is worth, then we start model prototyping. And this is, I'm going to insist on this idea a lot. We are building the simplest model that works. That means that as data scientists or data engineers, we know we could do better models, but we know they would take longer and bring additional trouble. So we go step by step. We prove every hypothesis. I remember the previous speaker saying something similar along these lines. We verify that every step we do is giving us in the right direction. Thus, the first step has to be a baby step. The model of choice in here is MVG slash MVD. If you have been doing retention studies, it's fairly common. It basically fits on just this thing. Imagine the kind of data that we have in Cabify about a user being a cloud native company, where everything you do is tagged next to your user ID. Yet, we decided for this. Just with the purchase history in days of the customer, we could fit the algorithm with just three features and four parameters and the simplest way to fit a model, right? And actually, we realized that it worked. It works pretty cool. With the output of the model is the probability of that we should see you again. We call it be alive. You can see as an oppose of the probability to churn, but really because we are not a subscription-based thing, it's hard for us to define what's a churn, right? Like, you haven't used me in 1 month, in 3 months, like why do I have to make that arbitrary choice to define? So we went this way. And as you can see, the model basically learns, this is a particular user, and this is time, and this is when the user rode with us. So you can see that any time that he rides, we increase the probability to see him or her again, and also that the more he's retaining the platform, the slope is smaller, right? Because if I have been able to bring back to the platform to someone who has been away for a month, I don't worry too much if he's gone for 15 days, right? Maybe it's just that he doesn't need my service so often. Of course, I can discretize this space, and I can start doing actuators that do things or they do not do things when different users go through those thresholds. Of course, I have this classic guy that we like. We have this bad news guy, which is like apparently he loved us and then left for good. Very bad story there. Or people who just use them but very infrequently, but they are loyal. Of course, because we can do this with every customer, we can draw the distribution of a certain city compared to the distribution of another city and see if we have a healthier user base in some market compared to others. Then remember, we go to, okay, let's experiment. And as you can see, and you can imagine, the experiment here is pretty straightforward. I keep some people in control group, and among people in treatment group, I go through the model and I give discounts to that the model shows they have higher potential of living, right? And of course, in the first attempt, we get something like this. Yeah, 1.something% improvement, really not significant. When you do this several times, you end up with what you actually wanted. In here, I'm plotting time, and in here, I'm plotting profitability of the user. Of course, because I am giving discounts, my treatment group at the beginning has less profitability because I am investing farther in them. But I am proving that over time, the treatment group has more profitability than the control group. Therefore, I have return on investment or retention. OK, and now it comes the fun part, which is, OK, we did this with the scripts for two cities during 2 weeks. And this means like people were like running the scripts. CRM was like manually launching the campaigns. Everything that you need, that you can imagine that it needs to happen for this. And then, okay, how do we make this automatic? And then the things get a bit crazier, right? Hopefully, we had a proper data lake and data warehouse by the time. And we have a talented group of data engineers to help us and build these pipelines. Super cool, very good looking, to process the data. But it really takes time. Again, one simple model in production is much more effective than 1 million amazing models as prototypes. So keep things simpler because they are simpler to productize, to be productized. Along the way, you can nevertheless generate value, right? We try to be agile, and I think we kind of achieve, as in for months. Some engineers were coming to the office Monday, 9 a.m., and they were manually launching the scoring process and monitoring. We were building in Tableau the visualization so the marketing team would know what we were doing and which are the people affected. And the end, this, I think we released this just a month ago, which is finally the interface that we always wanted to give to our local teams in marketing. They can simply log in, say how much money they have for retention this month, and then everything will happen magically. But we have been delivering value for over a year. Of course, because we were launching manually, we couldn't serve all markets. So we say, OK, you can choose 3 markets, the ones that are more critical at the time. OK, so for those, we were doing manual things. And also, it was super useful when someone that has to build this interface has to launch Monday 9 a.m. manually the things, because then he has or she has a huge incentive to like get it done, right? You are basically automating yourself. But when we run the postmortem, we realize that, yeah, the problem dimension and model prototype cycles are fairly fast, mostly because we have knowledge repo and a proper warehouse and data lake. But getting them production ready, not so fast. That's probably a conservative estimate. So I think it's pretty clear where our bottleneck was. In learnings, okay, we have massive impact. We learned a lot about how to do retention on ride hailing. we were able to bring proof of context to real impact on customer very fast. But we had this huge among the bad things is that we had a very complicated process of like translating things from Python scripts to like real code production ready. We have a problem with the model infrastructure. It was very hard to know which version of the model was in production versus which prototype in the repo. And probably the worst of all is like if I would have to run a V2 of the model, it would not be much faster than the V1, which is bad. So we realized we need to be one platform cooler. Let me introduce you to Likaion, which is Cabify's machine learning platform. Why a machine learning platform? If I, as I said before, we shouldn't build many things on our end or reinventing the wheel, but we truly realized we had problems that we could solve all at once. The first one is pretty straightforward, and I would like data scientists to be able to push to production machine learning models without talking to any engineer, as a goal, as a dream. I would like to fix the gap between training data and predict data, because sometimes part of the problems is between production and prototype is that you don't have the version of the data ready in the data lake that will be actually input in your model in an execution environment. And this debugging this is you're gonna die if you before doing that. Monitoring model performance is something that for every automated decision maker we were building, we will have to do it again, right? And explain a new set of engineers what's trained, what's test, what's the area under the curve, what's all of those we needed to start from scratch with any engineering team that was implementing a new machine learning model. We wanted to ensure that models are reproducible because we are giving them like really the decisions, the power of deciding things in our marketplace. So the less, more or less I have convinced my boss that the dynamic pricing is good, but for sure he can challenge me on why we made this price this time at this time. And I have to be able to give some sort of an answer, at least. What would have happened in this variable would have been 3 instead of 2, right? Also, we are deploying many models. To be honest, we are not yet deploying thousands of models, but the way we are going, this is where we are ending. And probably this is something we need now. That is like our models sometimes have to answer thousands of prediction requests in a second. So, and this is not something that you can achieve with just one script. So part of our bringing to production means scaling up to these levels, and it was part of the challenge. In a nutshell, we are building Likaion to unleash experimentation because we want data scientists to iterate as much as possible and as fast as they want. And we were not able to remember our 37 weeks production in cycle. We were not achieving that before. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the platform. I'm going to not get into technical, just the two big parts and why they are there. The first is a feature store. How many of you are familiar with the feature store concept? OK, not many. Therefore, the explanation. First is the part that has, I'm gonna do this first. When you grow as a company, or at least in our case, and you go all microservices and all distributed and stuff, simple aggregation, like how many writes has user 123 done with me, is far from trivial because, you know, duplications and all these things that happen in distributed systems. So it's amazing that if I have counted the number of trips per user for my SRE model that I previously introduced, if a data scientist is building a fraud model, they can simply fit on this previous calculation for this other project, right? Sounds simple, but those of you who have been in large enough ecosystem probably can feel about the value of this, because really calculating the features is many times is over 80 or 90% of the job. If we calculate the future, these features can have value by themselves, even before any decision-making system happened. And this actually has happened to us. The SRE outputs something like, how much are you going to consume in the next month? So even before getting full production ready with the discount system, the team building the customer the support, the tools for the customer support, they were feeding from here to, so when you you complain to Cabify because you have some sort of trouble, they know you are a top customer or you are not such a top customer, and they can treat you accordingly. So this part actually started providing value before Likayon was completely ready. We have different storages for different purposes, and we close the, but the data is the same. So there is no difference between train and predict data. Just happened that the data in production is served from Bigtable. Bigtable is Cassandra-like, or I mean, it's one of these databases that you, if you give them a key in a few hundred, at most 100 milliseconds, you have a value. And BigQuery is a data warehouse, so it's the kind of database that can you give me 1 million users and these four features, and you will have them in 20 seconds. So these are two different use cases. BigQuery, we use it to train and to develop the models, and Bigtable, we use it to serve it in production. But the data is ensured that it's the same in the both. And because we are doing this, we, by definition, have a consistent way of calculating features. Where the, remember the super simple example that I gave you before. How many trips has this user done in this week? Okay, a trip belongs to a week if started on the week or it's end in the week. And this might sound stupid, but you know, when you are telling a driver in the screen in the app that he has done 20 rides, and in the bonus system, you are telling them that he's only done 19 and therefore bonus doesn't apply for him, then you start appreciating the value of consistently calculating things and calculating them just one. So that's something we also got from the feature store. And then the real magic is, okay, I have a model and I wanna bring it to production. How that happens? Okay, so we have several pieces. We have a repository of models. So a model is actually, I'm going to mention later, is MLflow, the thing we're using. But this is like a chunk of bytes that this is my model. OK, here is the file. You could have it in a pen drive, right? So there is the model. There are Airflow jobs to train, evaluate, or simply to wrap it to production. And then there is a management that makes sure that if you update the model to a newer version, it deploys to as many containers of the model as needed. And then there is a serving that you basically get an API front, and maybe behind there are 1,000 containers, and they extract from you, right? So you can query from that endpoint as much as you need. Model train and service, probably the biggest challenge is like, how do we make sure that data scientists know exactly what's in production? And actually, this is something we start making our own solution. And 2 weeks later, we realize MLflow existed. And we basically erase everything we do. And it's like, let's go with the standard, because we are not here to reinvent more things. But the cool thing of MLflow is like, is the contract between the engineering and the science on what's in production. That's the best way I learned on how to put it. So a real example, actually, of the SRE model that we saw before is that, OK, someone is hitting the predict API saying that they want an SRE prediction for Spain, because maybe we have different models trained for different markets. Actually, we want the prediction from version 4, and we want the prediction from this particular user ID. So what this does is it makes sure that the model actually exists and it has some deployment over there. And the other thing is like, okay, SRE for this version has these three features. Remember that the three features that we saw before: frequency, recency, and age. And it actually gathers those from the Bigtable in the feature store. So in the end, you are hitting a container somewhere that has the version you wanted of the model. You have the features that were just got from the feature store. And out of this, you have a prediction on how likely are we to see user 123 again as of today. That's basically how it works. And then how it works, imagine you are a data scientist and you want to bring another feature into the model for a new version, because you have realized that if you add another feature, accuracy will increase. Okay, you go to the feature manifest, you write that you want a rider conversion rate, you put some description so other data scientists can reuse it from their models. And as of now, we are supporting SQL queries, but our plan is to support non-SQL queries. Basically, how to calculate, and then you have a new version of the model that you publish into the repo. You train the model with the new feature. Hopefully, this training confirms what you saw in your notebook, that this increases accuracy. And if that's the case, you hit deploy. We kill all the containers with the previous version of the model, and now we deploy as many containers with the new version of the model. That's basically how we do. So just wrapping up, the take-home messages is that's the way we do smart decisions and Cabify. For this, we were able to basically reuse something that someone else in the world has done for the same problems that we were. And we were happy about it. For this part, we need to build our own little thing. And we truly expect Likayon to move Cabify to the next level. And before coming to the talk, I had a conversation with part of the senior leaders in the team on some of the models that we have built. For example, SRE, this is the one we have been discussing in the talk. We know he has brought over $5 million in return on investment yearly, but it took 37 weeks to bring to production. And they are fairly confident that Likayon, this is what do we consider a success for Likayon. Remember, Likayon is still being finished. We can do it in 2 weeks. Rosewood is a model to fight fraud, basically credit card fraud. It's bringing over 1.5 million a year in chargebacks that we are not having. It took us really long time. This was the first machine learning model that we built in Cabify. Probably that's why it was so long to bring into production. Or Cabi Maps, which is basically is my talk in this conference last year. If you want to learn more about it, it's basically we saw to a deep neural network, the trajectories of our cars, but we never saw any map. And then based on that training, we asked the network to estimate how long it will take from A to B at this time in this date. And it's pretty amazing at capturing the city. So we do need to call commercial maps APIs. So we are reducing $4 million a year in basically Google Maps bill. And this is the kind of thing you can realize that even if we are overly optimistic here and those numbers actually double, because you know the reality is not Narnia, we will have a huge increase in the speed in which we move forward. So yeah, that's all I wanted to share with you today. Thank you for listening to me. I will take questions in Spanish or after the talk, or if someone feels English, sure. Yeah.
Yeah, better. I assume that your infrastructure, Likayon, is pretty much dependent on the Google Cloud infrastructure, or not?
As of today, yes. As I said before, we do not like to reinvent things.
Yeah.
But we realize that, for example, if we would have to move to AWS for strategic reasons, we know the equivalent in each of the pieces. So it wouldn't be that bad. And actually, we have changed our cloud provider last year in 2 weeks and a half, which is pretty impressive.
Okay. And the second, at the end of the day, the models are being served from a container, from a pod. I assume they expose or predict a method. How do you build us that container? Using Seldon or using, how do you create that? I assume that is automized.
It's automized, and I know the input is an ML flow, and the output is a Kubernetes deployment. But if you are interested about that, I think there are people in the room that can have a discussion with you better, because I really don't know that part. Anyone else? Okay, I'll be around.